Hi everyone, this is Ham Radio Now, episode 117 from the 2013 ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference. I'm Cindy Pierce, KD4ACW, and in this episode, Adam Farson, VA70J, will describe a technique for measuring receiver performance called NPR, not National Public Radio, but Noise Power Ratio. For some hams, receiver performance is really important, not just how weak a signal they can hear, but how well the receiver can pick out the weak ones when some really strong signals are nearby, and also how well the receiver rejects image signals in intermod. Adam will show you that you don't need a lab full of test equipment to measure many critical performance specs, except that this cartoon from his website leads me to believe that he maybe thinks you do. No, you can do it with some old surplus test gear that used to cost big bucks, but now you can get it cheap. We'll get to Adam's talk in a minute, but first, thanks to everyone who made this series of DCC videos possible, beginning with you and your support of Gary's Kickstarter. Pledges from individual hams made up over half of the contributions. We had three corporate underwriters. There's Tapper itself. Tapper is a membership group dedicated to everything digital and amateur radio, from packet all the way up to high-performance software-defined radio. If you're going to the Dayton Hamvention this year, Tapper will have their booth, plus a forum and a dinner. And they're planning the 2014 DCC. Stop by their website, tapper.org, that's tapr.org, and get details as they're available. We also want to thank Flex Radio Systems. Of course, Flex has been deep into software-defined radio and digital technology since their beginning, always pushing the limits of what can be done in amateur radio. Their new 6000 series takes them a big step forward. By putting all the computing power inside the radio, they made it possible to do the A to D conversion right up at the antenna connector, with almost everything else happening in the digital domain, all controlled by software that can run on low-powered computers on low-bandwidth connections. Check them out at their website, flexradio.com. And it's Ellicraft's turn for the longer message, so here's Gary to tell you all about them.
Ellicraft has built their way up to a pretty wide variety of radios and peripherals. Their flagship radios are the K3 and KX3 transceivers. The K3 is a software-defined radio under the hood, but it comes disguised as a conventional radio with all the knobs, dials, buttons, and displays you'd expect in a full-featured HF radio. And I say HF, but it includes 6 meters and even 2 meters with an optional transverter, and that fits right inside the case. You can get it either as a kit, and that would be a no-soldering kit, or fully assembled, and either a 10-watt or 100-watt transmitter. And it's modular, so you can start simple and add the extra pieces to build up the radio later. Some more of those extras include a subreceiver, an automatic antenna tuner, and a digital voice recorder. And I guess I should mention that the receiver features extremely high performance specs. A very cute feature of the K3 is the ability to decode RDI and PSK31 and display the text scrolling across the screen, and send those digital modes using a keyer paddle to generate the letters.
So we're actually sending RTTY right now, even though you hear it as CW on the keyer paddle.
Okay, you got to know CW to do that, because you're keying in your text in Morse code characters. That's just a little bit about the K3, so stop by the Ellicraft website, ellicraft.com, for more details. And the KX3 is a unique little radio. It's a 10-watt HF plus 6-meter and optional 2-meter radio. It looks like a control head for a more conventional mobile radio, but that's the whole thing. And there's room inside for 8 AA batteries to make it a complete standalone QRP station. Okay, you do need to add an antenna. It also does RDI and PSK31 right inside the radio, scrolling the text on the display, and the keyer paddle that inputs the text bolts right on the bottom of the case. Yes, you can also use the paddle to send real CW, and I get the impression that Ellicraft is subtly encouraging you to learn Morse code. The KX3 has got a pretty darn good receiver, maybe not quite as good as the K3, but way better than you might expect in this little box, including 32-bit DSP, and you can update the firmware with a PC. Ellicraft has a nifty 100-watt amp to make it pretty much a full-power, full-featured HF rig, if you must. And again, I've just scratched the surface. Okay, maybe a deep scratch, but there's lots more to learn. I'll round this out with a quick mention of some of the other Ellicraft products. There's the P3 PAN adapter, 200 kHz wide for now, but wider is coming, and more features than I can talk about for now. the real-time internet remote for the K3, a 500-watt solid-state amp, a high-power auto-tuner. The K2 is still around, the cute KX1 ultra-portable CW transceiver, and the K1 is still around too. All right, you got to go to their website to see more. All of Elecraft's products are sold directly from their website worldwide, so stop by elecraft.com.
Nicely done, dear. You make that announcer thing look really easy. Now, back to Seattle and Adam Faison's talk on NPR. That's noise power ratio from the 2013 DCC.
Okay, so I'd like to introduce Adam Faison, VA7OJ. He also has another call sign, AB4OJ, so he's collecting OJ call signs in case you have one.
In fact, the U.S. call came first, and then I got the Canadian
call.
The strength of it.
His talk is on noise power ratio testing of HF receivers.
Well, good afternoon, everybody, and thank you very much for coming. Those of you who have worked in the telecom industry, going back a number of years to the days of analog multi-channel carrier systems on microwave, SATCOM, etc., probably have heard of noise power ratio testing. The telecom carriers used NPR testing to characterize multi-channel analog FDM systems. The way it works basically is that a notched noise band is injected at the transmit baseband input with notch filters at the low, mid, and high ends of the baseband. At the other end of the transmission system, there's a special receiver with corresponding bandpass filters. These are actually channel filters analogous to IF filters in a conventional radio receiver, which read the idle channel noise, in other words, the noise power in the channel filter with the transmit notch filter in and out. The fundamental purpose of noise power ratio testing is to apply a band of noise to the system. The noise will introduce reciprocal mixing and IMD and throw noise into the empty channel created by the notch. The higher the quality of the system, in other words, the better its linearity and the better its reciprocal mixing behavior, the less noise will be induced into the notch. During the period of usage of these analog FDM transmission systems, the ITU specified a maximum noise power ratio as an end-to-end performance objective, and so did Intelsat. This test method fell into obsolescence when PCM transmission systems, and now, of course, TCP/IP and VoIP, completely eclipsed analog FDM, the process that began in the 1970s, 1980s. Now the NPR test instrumentation is very inexpensive on the surplus market, which is fortunate, certainly fortunate for me and for a couple of colleagues of mine who are pursuing the same test method. We can now use these noise generators for HF receiver testing. Many of the notch filters happen to fall into low frequency, medium frequency, and high frequency broadcast and amateur bands. The typical generators are made by the German firm Wandel & Goltermann and by Marconi Instruments of England. The impairments in an HF receiver, broadly speaking, are IMD, odd and even order. IMD from a large number of carriers will approach Gaussian noise in its behavior, as we will see. Reciprocal mixing noise, when the RF signal or noise in the RF passband mixes with the phase noise of the local oscillator. Then there's image response and IF leakage. The applied noise will show up in the image channel as what we call image channel noise. It also can also show up in the first IF as a noise as a noise response caused by IF leakage. Odd order IMD, the third order IMD with which we're very familiar in testing SSB transmitters and evaluating HF receivers. The products are usually in the same band as the received signal. Even order IMD products are not in the same band as their constituent parts. So, for example, as I showed here, if you have two broadcasters on 8 and 6 megahertz, you'll end up with a product in the 20-meter band. In a crowded band, multiple carriers generate a lot of these products. In fact, the limiting case, as we can see from this diagram here, is where your IMD products in red on the right-hand diagram, caused by the multiple carriers in blue. If you draw an envelope around the red part, you'll see that it looks very much like the bell curve of Gaussian noise. Reciprocal mixing noise is explained here. A strong interferer mixes with the phase noise of the local oscillator. There's the interferer, local oscillator with its noise pedestal, very typical of classical phase lock loops. Old-fashioned LC-VFOs have very low phase noise, crystal oscillators even more. A well-designed DDS can be very clean as regards phase noise. Well, the phase noise mixes with a strong interferer to throw noise into the IF channel. In fact, just as an aside, if the reciprocal mixing noise dynamic range RMDR of the receiver is worse than the DR3, then reciprocal mixing is the dominant impairment. And however good the DR3 number, reciprocal mixing is what's going to mask that weak signal you're looking for in the contest or the pileup. Image response would be acceptance of signals at the operating frequency plus or minus twice the IF. In modern receivers with a high first IF, RF preselector will suppress the image response almost completely, which is why they went to the high IF in the 1960s. I lived through that period when I was working for Raycal back then. IF leakage is acceptance of signals at or close to the first IF, such as a 9 megahertz first IF. On 30 meters, you're going to have problems. Not on a receiver with a high IF at the first IF. What I've shown here is a diagram of a typical superhet with choke points, active stages that can generate IMD in their own right. I've sort of neglected the DMOD because it's fairly low down the chain. The local oscillator is your source of phase noise. Wideband noise applied to the RF input, which makes it relevant to the NPR test, will provoke IMD products at the IMD choke points. Another grave offender can be switching or steering diodes in the RF bandpass filters and crystal or mechanical filters in the signal path, especially if they're fairly close to the RF input. In addition to IMD and phase noise, image response and IF leakage can arise if the RF bandpass filter is too wide to attenuate undesired signals at image frequency and IF. Now, this is all in a conventional superhead-type receiver. Direct sampling SDR presents a totally different set of advantages and issues. Now, all these products will appear in the IF and audio chain as added noise. As the principle of the noise power ratio test, we apply wideband Gaussian noise to the receiver input, termed noise loading. The noise loading provokes added noise in the receiver, as we've seen. The added noise power is a measure of the overall receiver performance. The less noise is added, the better the receiver. A perfect receiver will add no noise at all. We measure added noise power by creating an idle channel in our applied noise band by placing a deep notch filter, a band stop filter, just wider than the receiver's IF filter at the output of the noise generator. The receiver is tuned to place the IF channel in the middle of the notch. A bandpass filter ahead of the notch filter defines the applied noise bandwidth. Ideally, only the added noise generated by the receiver's impairments will appear in the notch. This noise is termed idle channel noise. NPR is the ratio of the noise power in the idle channel divided by the noise power in a channel equal in bandwidth to the idle channel but outside the notch. Yeah, this little diagram illustrates that. Here is the applied noise with the notch. This is the receiver IF channel. The noise power ratio is P1 over P2, actually 10 log P1 over P2. It shows up in the receive audio output as a rise in the idle channel noise. What we do is we increase the noise loading in testing a superhet receiver. We increase the noise loading until the idle channel noise increases by 3 dB as measured by an RMS audio voltmeter at the output. It's actually a pretty simple process. And then we subtract the MDS from the noise loading, where there's a calculation involving the ratio of the bandwidth of the applied noise to the IF channel bandwidth, and the number it yields is the noise power ratio. The higher the noise power ratio, the better the receiver. The highest possible noise power ratio is the depth of the notch filter. A narrowband test, such as we see in the prevailing test protocols, are, for example, the two-tone IMD tests, which produce measurable second and third order products. Generally, the two-tone test doesn't apply sufficient signal power to provoke passive IMD. Passive IMD, I might remark, is IMD caused by passive devices being driven into nonlinearity, such as a crystal, which has a linear operating region. Above that region, the mechanical flexure of the crystal is no longer proportional to the applied voltage. So the crystal becomes a nonlinear device, otherwise known as an IMD generator. Same thing can happen to ferrite or iron cores in inductors and to some capacitor dielectrics as well. If you hit them hard enough, they become nonlinear. An offset signal tone test will generate reciprocal mixing noise, which is how reciprocal mixing noise is measured. The weakness of narrowband tests, perhaps, is that they don't accurately reflect the weak signal performance degradation due to multiple strong signals and the numerous undesired products these signals generate. A given receiver may have excellent narrowband numbers and yet may miss a weak signal on a crowded band. The NPR method emulates a band filled with many strong signals. An example, in a noise band 5.6 megahertz wide, which is one of the bands that I use, with minus 9 dBm of total noise loading, this is equivalent to 1,200 SSB channels adjacent to each other, all at 30 over 9. So it's a really brutal test. One can also zero in on potential trouble spots in a repeater by measuring NPR in various receiver configurations, such as RF preamp in or out, different IF filters, different preselectors, etc. The bottom line here is narrowband tests don't really give a true picture. As part of the theoretical background of an earlier analysis done by a colleague of mine, Gianfranco Verbana, I2VGO, he determined that there is an optimum noise loading level at which the noise induced in the receiver by the noise loading equals the thermal noise of the receiver. This will generate idle channel noise at the noise floor. Therefore, this point can be established by measuring the audio output of the receiver. When it rises by 3 dB, this is the optimum noise loading point, and it's at that point that we record the NPR. It's pretty simple. So the only instruments you need to do this test are the noise generator and a RMS voltmeter, such as an HP400, HP3400, etc. Okay, the noise generator is the trick. Because of the availability of these noise generators in surplus, I was able to get hold of a Wandel and Goltermann RS50 generator, which I'll show you a picture of it shortly. Basically consists of a noise source, which is a 75 ohm resistor at room temperature with an awful lot of gain following it, then a bandpass filter to determine the noise loading band, then an output amplifier, then the bandstop filter, which determines the channel frequency or the test frequency, then an ALC loop, which holds the output of the generator constant irrespective of what filters are in line and what their insertion loss may be, and a precision output attenuator. I then go from a 75 to 50 ohm transformer, which is a mini circuits product, to the receiver under test and then to the RMS voltmeter. The filters I happen to have with my noise generator cover long wave and medium wave broadcast bands, 160, 80, 60, and 40 meter amateur bands. It's the luck of the draw. I mean, the filter frequencies are known because the channel frequencies are specified by the ITU, and when you get one of these generators, you're on a perpetual quest on eBay and other sources to try and find the filters. The equipment is quite inexpensive. One generator that came with almost all the filters I needed cost me $50. That's about $25,000 worth of equipment when it was new. You select a bandpass filter matching the bandstop filter. The actual bandwidth of the filter is not important because you can also calculate NPR from the noise density as measured or determined in dBm per hertz. But the idea of the bandpass filter is you want the noise band to be somewhat wider than the receiver's preselector so that you're subjecting the preselector to this onslaught of noise as well in order to provoke any passive IMD that might exist in the preselector. Typically, the band stop filters have a 95 dB stop band attenuation, and the stop band at the bottom of the notch is 3.3 kHz wide. This is the selection of filters which I have for my generator. I've since added another filter. I've got that filter now. I just got it the other day, 60 to 552. There are two main manufacturers of these instruments, Fundel and Goldemann, and Marconi. Both makes are available in the surplus market. The alternative to being dependent on this relatively rare surplus equipment is to use an arbitrary waveform generator, which can generate a notched noise band of the required bandwidth with a notch of the required width and depth. But such a generator can be very, very expensive, coming from Agilent or from Rohde & Schwarz. This is the spectrum of the noise generator output with two notch filters selected. That's the bandpass filter, which is essentially flat from 60 kilohertz to its highest frequency. And I've inserted two notches for the sake of illustration. This spectrogram was just taken with a spectrum analyzer with averaging to smooth out the noise. This is one of the bandstop filters. The IF channel of the receiver sits comfortably in between the flanks of the notch. You don't want the IF bandwidth to be greater than the notch bandwidth, and you want the notch depth to be such that the floor of the notch is below the receiver's noise floor, because you don't want noise to leak around the filter into the receiver. That'll degrade the accuracy of your measurement. This is a typical noise generator with a set of band pass and band stop filters and the two-stage attenuator, integral dB and integral dBm, and 0 to 1 dB fine attenuation. These keys are for switching the band stop filters in and out, increasing the output by 10 dB, and shutting off the output entirely. This is a simplification of the method for deriving NPR. Once you've got the what I call PTOT here, total power, which is the total noise loading, the bandwidth ratio is 10 times the log of the RF bandwidth, or the noise, total noise bandwidth, divided by the bandwidth of the receiver IF. The total RF bandwidth is the filter minus the bandwidth of the notch. I use SSB with a 2.4 kilohertz bandwidth because it's compatible with the notch. To perform the measurement, you set up the receiver for SSB, switch in a roofing filter if applicable, set the RF gain at maximum, turn on the AGC because you want to test the receiver under its normal operating conditions, turn off the preamp, any attenuation, noise blank or noise reduction especially, turn on the preselector, tune the receiver to put the passband in the middle of the notch, turn off the noise source and set the AF gain for a minus 3 dB reading, turn on the noise source and simply adjust the output for a 3 dB increase until the AC meter reads 0 dB, and then calculate NPR using the equation on the previous slide. You repeat the test with different combination of preselector, roofing filter, and preamp, and write down the results. I have in an article on my website, I have a fairly large but database of receivers I've tested. Now, testing NPR on a direct sampling SDR is a somewhat different exercise, because for a direct sampling SDR, one can derive a theoretical value of NPR. It's possible to calculate the maximum NPR achievable with a given bit count making certain assumptions. The assumptions are that you're testing at a noise bandwidth of half the sampling rate and that the ADC is noiseless and that there's no insertion loss or gain in front of the ADC. Going from there, you can normalize for the noise bandwidth in use and for the noise floor of the ADC. So then you can get a theoretical or calculated number and compare your measured number with it, which is a very powerful tool for assessing direct sampling receivers. There are many problems, as we've been finding. There are many problems when you try to do two signal tests on an ADC, because first of all, the IMD of an ADC is dependent on the input power. Secondly, it's independent of the signal of the test signal spacing, quite unlike an analog receiver. And thirdly, the point at which you actually do the measurement for the sake of providing published data for receiver comparison is somewhat indeterminate at the present time. With NPR, at least for the moment, what has been proposed is to set the noise loading such that you're just below the point at which the ADC clips. The point at which the ADC clips is also a matter of some discussion, because there is a hard clipping point in the ADC, but different receivers bring out the indication of clipping in different ways according to the manner in which the software was implemented. So this is something that's also being studied right now. For the moment, what I've been doing in running NPR tests on direct sampling SDRs is to turn the noise loading up until I hit the clip point. For example, in the Perseus direct sampling SDR receiver from Italy, there's a red clip icon that comes on, and I just back off and wait till it stops clipping for about 10 seconds. And then it's easy after that. You read the NPR off the spectrum scope. In fact, I will show you a slide which illustrates this. Now, just for the moment, here are some typical numbers for a conventional receiver, which I tested a few months ago. The Kenwood TS-590, which is an interesting case because it has both in-band and high first IF. I would say that on the scale of NPR, from my own experience, on the scale of NPR versus receiver merit, if you like, anything close to 90 is excellent. Probably, I'll say this much, may sound a little prejudiced because I own one, but the IC7700 is at the top of the ranking. The highest number I got on that one was 87, remembering that the notch depth is 95. Anything between 80 and 90 is excellent. At 1940 and 3886 kilohertz, the Kenwood TS-590 selects the in-band first IF with a reasonable crystal filter at 11 megahertz, if I remember rightly, and 11.374 megahertz. That yields a pretty good NPR. When you go to the other two frequencies, which use the high first IF, the filter is not as good. There may be some passive IMD in the filter. The numbers drop, not by an awful amount, but they drop. And there's a slight degradation with the preamp. So the 590 shows up very well on this test. There may be passive IMD in the first IF filter, reciprocal mixing, and IMD in the preamp, a little bit of IMD in the preamp. But they've done a pretty good job going on the NPR test, and on what I've seen, they've done a pretty good job with this receiver. If you want to see a comprehensive table of receivers tested, the paper in the proceedings contains a database of all the receivers I've tested to date. Now, coming back to the direct sampling SDR, you adjust the noise loading until you just see clipping, back it down again until there's no clipping for 10 seconds. NPR is equal to the notch depth as displayed on the radio scope. In this case, with the preselector on, dithering on, and the preamp on, I was getting 73 dB NPR. Dithering is a process by which a random signal approximating to noise is either generated within the ADC or applied to it by a dither generator on the radio's RF board. What this does is it introduces randomization into the input of the ADC and breaks up the IMD products into little pieces which kind of land on the noise floor, so to speak, and show up as a bit of extra noise. So you can kill the IMD at the price of degrading the noise floor by a couple of dB. It's actually quite dramatic when you see it happen on the scope. Now, to relate the theoretical to the actual value of NPR, there's a very good paper put out by ADI, Analog Devices Incorporated, which it's called Tutorial Mic Tango 005. It presents this set of curves. Each physical bit number has associated with it a theoretical maximum NPR and the corresponding noise loading. This is based upon two assumptions. The ADC is noiseless, and the noise bandwidth is half the sampling rate, the Nyquist frequency. Okay, how does this relate to our real-world noisy ADC with a real-world somewhat more modest noise bandwidth? I've got some calculations here. What I did was I derived the noise floor of this perfect ADC, and then I've derived an NPR figure from it. Now, what you have to do is you have to plug the actual noise floor of your ADC back into this number. So the NPR of the so-called noiseless ADC is 74.01 dB, as we saw from this previous slide. Yeah, here we have for our 14-bit ADC, we have 74.01 dB NPR. In the proceedings, you'll need to look on the errata sheet. Unfortunately, there was an error in the original paper, and I put out an errata which gives it 85.4 dB noise power ratio for the perfect noiseless 16-bit ADC. Of course, there's no such thing as a perfect noiseless ADC. Well, let's go with the 74.01 dB number for the moment. So what we do is we add the noise, we plug the noise floor of the real ADC into the 74.01, so we end up with 65.25, which is the NPR of the ADC used in the Perseus at a noise bandwidth of 40 megahertz, which is half the sampling rate. But we're not testing at half the sampling rate, we're testing at a noise bandwidth of 5.537 megahertz, which is that of the bandpass filter used with the band stop filter at 5340. So now we can predict the calculated NPR, 65.25 plus 8.6. 8.6 is the process gain caused by the reduction in bandwidth from 40 to 5.537 megahertz. So we plug this 8.6 back into that number and we get 73.85. Call it 74 dB, which is the calculated NPR for the Perseus. Now we have something very valuable here. We've got a performance number that we've been able to calculate as a benchmark for the receiver. Okay, the typical measured NPR was 72, 73 dB, which is pretty close to the calculated value. Now, when you're doing an NPR test on a direct sampling receiver, I believe that if you get a number that's close to the calculated one, the receiver is working the way it's supposed to. If you suddenly see an NPR which is significantly less, you know you've got a problem. In one receiver I tested, with one configuration, the NPR dropped from the 70s, from 73 or so to 65. That showed up passive IMD in the preselector filter for that specific frequency, or frequency range, because the next frequency range up, what I did was I switched filters and went from 1940 to 2438. Which would be the next filter up in the preselector. Problem went away. So, you know you've got a problem in the, you've got a bad inductor or something in the preselector. So, as a diagnostic tool, the NPR test is pretty valuable. This leads us on to the final slide, where one of my colleagues was testing a number of receivers for the medium and long wave bands using the Marconi generator, which works the same as the WNG. on one receiver, there was a little local oscillator spur, and the NPR was decent. I apologize to the manufacturer for identifying as receivers, but they're no longer in that business. In the other receiver, you've got the yellow is producing a forest of spurs. Ooh, yick. This shows up rather badly in the NPR. So what you can do is you disconnect the yellow and connect a nice, quiet, high-end signal generator with known low phase noise and no spurs to speak of. The NPR will come back to this. Yeah, let's get ourselves a new local oscillator, guys. So, well, that was the final slide here. There are a number of links. I would like to suggest that you go to my website, ab40j.com, and look at my original web article. It evolves all the time as I add material to it. So at this point, I'd like to thank you very much for your interest. And are there any questions?
So I did some of this testing in the microwave band, and I found it really hard to find white noise generators that go up to like 6 gig. So I ended up emulating with OFDM because it's a little broader band signal. And by the way, for anyone interested, our modems do like 2 to 1 NPR. It's really bad. Do you have any suggestions for how I might get some noise generators up in microwave frequencies, let's say up to about 6 gig or so?
Okay, but the only suggestion I can make is that you get hold of an HF generator such as the one I've been using, and you can, it is legitimate to heterodyne the noise band up.
Hi, Tom, NHZM. You were talking about direct conversion or direct sampling receivers and preselectors, and it seems like most of those just have a low pass in front of them, which means you would have to generate your noise all the way from DC to 30 megs or 50 megs or wherever they go, right? Or am I misunderstanding something?
Well, the thing is this, that you can, there are two ways of calculating. Well, you don't calculate the NPR necessarily with a direct sampling receiver, but you can apply a wide noise band if you want to exercise the entire bandwidth of the front end. This is certainly possible. These noise generators, if you switch out the band limiting filter, you can get a noise band which is 3 dB down at 12 or 25 megahertz. So you can get close to that. Normally what I do is I test within a band of a few megahertz. Now this may not exercise the low pass filter to its fullest extent, but what one can do, I've been working on the assumption that a low-pass filter is not likely to have a passive IMD problem if it's 30 megahertz wide. But if what you can do is you can switch out the band-limiting filter, the band-pass filter, which is called a band-limiting filter as well, and then rerun the test and observe with a direct sampler, you observe the spectrum scope. If you see the right noise floor, the noise floor in the notch, the bottom of the notch rise, when you increase the bandwidth to the full bandwidth available, that suggests that there may be a passive IMD problem in the low-pass filter. So that would be a way of looking at it.
I see your direct sampling receivers have performance of about 70 dB, but you mentioned that a fine analog receiver has performance of 80 dB under your testing regime. Well, does that indicate intrinsic superiority of the analog receiver?
I can't really look at it that way because my thinking is sort of evolving into a realization that NPR in a direct sampling receiver and NPR in an analog receiver may be two different animals, because with the direct sampler, your benchmark is the calculated value, which is in the 70s. With an analog receiver, the maximum possible NPR is the depth of the notch filter. So if you had a perfect noiseless linear mixer and a perfect LO with no phase noise whatsoever and a perfectly linear IF amplifier, etc., IF and baseband chain, you'd be able to go all the way down to the bottom of the notch, and then you say your NPR is 90 dB or better. So yeah, they are sort of two different animals. Exactly how to resolve that dichotomy, I haven't quite figured that out yet.
I haven't figured it out either, but it does seem that it is in fact has a certain real-world aspect in that you're flooding your bandwidth with a bunch of undesirable signals. It's the job of the receiver to reject them, and it appears that the analog ones reject them better, at least on the face of it.
Well, the analog receiver will have will have pre-selection, which will protect its mixer from unwanted signals way outside its passband, but then you can put pre-selection ahead of a direct sampling SDR as well. I think the real world, in other words, putting both radios on the air and examining their on-air performance in a contest or DX pile-up environment, or in Europe where you've got multi-megawatt broadcast transmitters down the street, will be the final arbiter. And the tests are only a tool or a help to guide you along the way.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you very much.